Well, we had a request to talk about community, spiritual community, and that symbol, and we started off with the four of us the first day, and so we'll just be very available and open and transparent about our experiences in spirituality and spiritual awakening. So feel free to ask us any questions. I think to start off, I'll just say that none of us had any clue about spiritual community. We didn't grow up thinking as little boys and girls, oh, when I grow older, I'll be in a spiritual community. In fact, I think it's safe to say none of us had even the faintest glimmering of such a thought. But we do have a great desire and devotion to the Holy Spirit and to Jesus to guide us and to use the symbols in whatever way would be helpful. And so these symbols have come to us and we've used them. And just like you're feeling the love and support and nurturing of everyone here as you go through these emotions, that's the way we felt. We felt, surprising. Never thought it would look this way, but it seems to be working, and that's the most important thing, that you go through the healing without knowing the form of how it's going to look or how ideas of how it's supposed to look or anything. So I think that's the first thing we can do is just open up a little bit, each of us, and just share how it's been for us, and the use of symbols in a very honest, integrous way. And also to mention there are variations, like Helena has her own little community in rural Sweden going now. And just this summer, Jenny and Francis found a house, Casa Nisi,
Misha.
Casa Misha, down about an hour outside of Barcelona. Yeah. How do you spell it?
M-E-I-X-A.
M-E-I-X-A.
In Spanish, it pronounces Misha.
Misha. Casa Misha. Okay, another word for me to learn.
What does the word mean,
Misha?
I have no idea.
Oh. We're just happy if we can pronounce it. We really don't know what anything means. We get more clueless by the day. We took a bike ride yesterday, and I was like huffing and puffing, and finally Helen and I sat down to meditate. We didn't know we were 5 minutes from the sea, but it worked out. But we're pretty clueless. But maybe we'll just share a little bit about the symbols, how we've used them over the years.
Mm. Oh, okay. What do you mean by symbols?
Well,
the bodies,
the bodies,
houses,
community, like we're sharing here in a kind of a communal experience for 5 days. For us, it's been years of this kind of living.
Yeah.
Like we're living right now. We're feeling how joyful and helpful this is. It's been years.
Well, yeah, when I first started traveling with David, it was just him and I, and I think it was maybe four or five more, I don't really remember the number, but it was just very tiny community. And then it just kind of grew by the years, and we never had an intention of going in any way, but people just kind of came as we were traveling the world, and we just heard about the message, and they just felt drawn to come in, like several of you here too. And then we would just grow larger and larger and more buildings and buildings, and all of a sudden David would talk about a new building somewhere, and you would just go like, okay, you wouldn't even hear the details, you know, you heard about the name, you just would hear, you know, a new building coming. And what happens is that you join in projects to see what arises when you're doing something. You know how you can sit down and meditate on the things that, you know, you see that okay, something is coming into the awareness of being healed, but when you have a project, some kind of a backdrop, you notice all your old patterns coming up in a very clear and direct way. You will notice all subtleties. Everything of what is needing to be healed is just arising automatically. So that's what we've been using for years, with many, many volunteers coming in and wanting to join in into this mind training and see just what arises in the moment. Because what we're doing is learning how to be done through, that it doesn't matter what we're doing, we're not really doing it, but as we're being with it. And that is something that we learn to be with instead of the doing, which means we let go of the attack thoughts that we have on ourselves, on others, on the things that we're doing. So it's all of those thoughts that are in the way of staying in the presence that gets washed away, and that you become lighter and lighter and lighter and brighter and brighter. And then it doesn't really matter what you do, but you can choose to be in this state because you don't allow those attack thoughts to come in. So that just continued the years that I was with David and Living Miracles and everyone there. And after 8 years, I felt it was maximized there. And I was guided to go back to Sweden, where I came from originally, and buy a house that was an all-year-round house, little one. And I was married at that time, and then we got a divorce in March. And I had no idea of, you know, getting the house was just like, okay, here we go. I was moving into a house that was completely empty, and then letting the spirit just, you know, put one furniture after another with a miracle story. Everything that is in there is a miracle story, because I simply had no money. So it was like the spirit was just given everything at the timing it was needed and with a miracle story. And that's how we become free of thinking that we provide for ourselves. Mm. That we got to be convinced that the spirit is carrying us. And that's in everything. So when you practice in an everyday life of just tuning into the presence of the spirit, you see that you are provided for in the thinking. So it's never about the form, it's in the thinking. You can be in this flow if you just dare to face whatever is there and is in the way. And you just say, okay, I see this, I want to heal this. And then you put it on the table like you have done here in the expression sessions or in the diets this morning. And you let the spirit take over. And so what happened after the divorce, actually, what happened was that all of a sudden, you know, people started moving into the house. I mean, I had no idea how this would be used. Like, I was just like, okay, feel the house, okay, buy the house. I mean, I didn't even have the money, so I took a loan. I couldn't even go to the bank, even taking a loan at a bank, you know. The angel of my mother, she would go like, okay, well, I can lend you money. Okay, good, great. And then here we go. And it's just complete trust. And I've seen it like all the time, like everything that has been needed has been provided for. So you were up on the stage yesterday with, you know, not knowing if you can pay the bills. I had it like that from like November up till I don't know what month this year, where every month I would not know how to pay the bills. But all of a sudden, the money would come in, and so that they could be paid all of the time. And again, it's so practical. This journey is so practical. We have to be convinced by the everyday practice. And that's what you do in community living. So the ones that have come to me, they've just kind of like been attracted to come. Like the first one just came because we were organizing a retreat together. And we were joining so deeply. And we're not really organizing a retreat. It was a retreat in Spain, by the way. And we were just coming together. And she just had more and more things coming up. And we would just join it. We were saying, like, this is not enough. We need to meet even more, you know? Like, why won't we meet every day, you know? So she's like, okay, I'll come over, you know? And I go, like, yay, okay. And so she came over. And then we had a retreat just some weeks or month ago or so, and it was a 1-week movie retreat. So they came in from England, two people were flying in from England, and then they just felt like, wow, this just feels so like wonderful to be here. We feel like we could stay. Can we stay for another week? You know, and I had been feeling this woman for the longest time. I've been working with her since half a year previous to that in an online movie course that I have, where we meet every week to watch movies together online and talk about what arises. And so she said, can I stay for 1 week? And I said, are you sure it's just 1 week? And she's like, no, I know, I know, I know, I can feel it, I can feel it. And she goes like, you know, I'm so afraid of big communities, but with yours, you know, I feel like, oh, I feel so at home here, I feel so safe, I can feel like I can really go deep here, you know. And so it was so wonderful. So she just, her friend that was traveling with her as well, he was also joining in, and he's temporarily visiting her actually from South Africa. So he would fly back to the UK and just get some more of her things and meet up with Kenneth and Leah there and then just fly back again. And now they're living here. She's committed for a year. She felt like, I have to commit. I have to make a commitment. I've never made a commitment in my whole life, but I have to commit. So she felt it's a year, you know, and that's what she's feeling. She said a year or maybe longer, who knows. And so it's like this beauty that you're given everything that you need when it's timing of whatever it is. And it's like the Spirit's always got the plan for us there. Just like David was talking about yesterday in the Q&A, it's like it's always there. We can never be left alone, ever.
Yay!
There it is. Yeah. Amen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was thinking, don't ask this question, but I already
do now.
Oh, you
got my pie.
There is. Sometimes I think it's a deep distrust in me, like, but in a way it's about money. Like, I totally feel safe in you. Well, maybe not. But like,
somewhat.
Yeah, sure. And then the question comes, like, I heard, like, one retreat I heard in New Mexico was €3,000, or a week in Spain is €500. And so I was like, sometimes I don't understand this. There is this trust, like, yeah, but 1 week, why should it be so expensive? You know, I don't know. And then I've made this. Do you know what I mean? It's like, why do it cost so much? Do you know, I don't know, sometimes. Yeah, actually the question is, do you have diamond rings in your pockets?
I don't think you have to have diamond rings in your pockets. As far as I know, it's just together.
What is that?
Well, we could talk about it in terms of... One time I was talking to Kirsten, who just published her book yesterday. I think it started publishing. I Married a Mystic. And, you know, she was so transparent about her issues around money, because when I would go down to New Zealand, which is where she grew up, where she was born and where she grew up is New Zealand. And in New Zealand, when you make things, gatherings and talks available on a donation basis, in New Zealand that means coins. Donations means coins. So they go, oh, it's on a donation basis. So they put like a little jar or pot up, and they put some little coins in. Probably the coins aren't even as valuable as they are in euros or pounds. From Great Britain, you know, these are tiny little New Zealand coins. I don't know what the currency is of New Zealand, but... And so, Kirsten was like, yeah, that's what they... When we say donations, when you say donations, David, they go, coins! And they come and they, like, you know, like, make a wish, throw a coin in the fountain or something like this. But practically speaking, they were like airline tickets, you know, you have to fly. And if it's one person, or if it's two, or three, or four, then you get into round trip, trans-Pacific airlines. And so Kirsten would even do a little preliminary talk saying, now I know we think here that donations are coins, but we actually need to support the Spirit's plan of covering costs, just covering costs. And so she would do a little 5-minute talk like, it doesn't mean coins. Like, thank you for your coins, and to cover airfares, we need more than that. And always there's been this spirit of no one should be turned away because they do not have the ability to pay. So I've done gatherings in third world countries and 40 some odd countries, and oftentimes there's a venue and we'll just try to, people will try to come in and listen and hear whatever they can do. The camping, I got an email, I think Alice was saying, listen, I really am to be there and I can camp, I have a tent, but I can only afford 50 euros. And then there are also things like Chris organized this, so he's aware of the coming in and the going out and all those things, and put the time and energy it takes for how many months? A lot of months, of a lot of communications. There's a lot of things involved. And so with that, you know, we have to even pray on guidelines for pricing or fees, putting books out on a donation basis. You have to cover the printing cost and the shipping cost and all those. It's really learning to turn money issues over to the Holy Spirit and just be connected to that. Like, what would you have me put down, or what should I write, or what should I say? There was a time early on where we had CDs available. First there was cassettes, and then there was CDs. And what did they call it? They burn CDs, and what's that? Stomp. You put stickers, and you stomp CDs. And Kirsten had spent like a couple days burning and stomping some CDs that we had available, that we would make available. And we were in Wisconsin in a little town called Sheboygan. Don't you like the sound of that? Sheboygan. You could name your child that. Sheboygan. Sheboygan. It's fun. It's a fun name. So we're in Sheboygan, and I'm giving a talk, and then at the end of the talk, I go, and freely we have received of Jesus Christ, and freely we shall give. And I was giving, oh, it's so much fun, and thank you all for coming, and I love you, and we have some booklets available. Oh, and Kirsten made some CDs available and everything. And, you know, if you want to leave a donation, you can, but it's freely offered and this and this. Well, she watched me give my spiel, and she had the thought, like, no, you don't need to say the word freely so many times. She's just emphasizing freely. Even though Jesus said, freely you have received, now freely give. That's what he taught. So, at the end of the gathering, there was a Hispanic woman there who had to go, but she went running over to the table, and Kirsten had made, burned and stomped a whole stack, a couple stacks of CDs, and the woman, in her glee, went and scooped up as many CDs as she could get in her palm of her hand. She just ran over to the table, she scooped them all up, she went, yay! And went running out the door. Didn't even put a coin. Let's just put... The person spent like 2 days making the CDs, and they were gone. Half of them all were out the window. And she was, of course, she couldn't even react. The woman was gone, was out there, and she couldn't even say, well, is it donation basket or something? It was too fast. So after that, we went over to Wisconsin, Portage, where Kathy and Bob live, and I did this 5 or 6 day retreat, and she put out her donation basket again, and I talked the first day, no donations. Second day, she had her eyes, after this CD thing, she had her eyes on the donation basket. Second day, I was talking like all day, not a single note or coin in there. The third day, she's watching. She she's getting more irritated and more upset about this whole donation thing. You know, like, this is not fair. This is, you're talking all day. And then she went in, and she finally got so irritated that she took it to Jesus. She prayed to Jesus and the Holy Spirit. Says, "What is it? I have a money issue." And when she was complaining to Jesus that people weren't making any donations at all, and also they'd taken all these CDs that she'd stumped, Jesus says, "Where are you withholding?" That's how he works. Where are you withholding? And it turns out that even though in our ministry, you know, we give over everything, we really don't hold on to possessions, private this, private that. We don't have privately owned things. We give it all, put it in the pool, which is like the Franciscans and the Essenes and, you know, Mother Teresa and so forth. But basically, she went into her mind and Jesus said, "Where are you withholding?" And she had... she had stashed money like squirrels stashed nuts. She had a little bank account there and a little savings account there, some stashed under the mattress. She was a little stasher, like a little squirrel, you know, that takes the nuts and goes, and then buries the nuts and then forgets where the nuts even are. But they're safe. The nuts are safe. So she had little stashes around, and Jesus pointed out to her all of her little stashes. As she was judging the people that were not donating, Jesus was pointing out all of her stashes. It was very healing. I don't know if that one's in the book or not, but that was a big one. So that's something that, yeah, money issues are going to come up because the ego is scarcity and lack. And there are things that sometimes there's long retreats or devotional retreats, and this was, Chris had to work out the numbers over like 5 days, but imagine if we did this for weeks or 4 weeks or 6 weeks, then you get into, you know, lodging, food, logistics, transportation. Most of our long devotional retreats have been over here in Spain, in Mallorca, and then if for example, back in the days, if we had 4 of us to fly there, then you have 4 transatlantic tickets, depending on where you're from.
I trust you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So we just
yeah, it costs
trust.
Money.
Yeah.
I know.
We just do the best that we can. And we also, I have to say, with Helena, with all of us, we have offered a lot of scholarships. We've had scholarships for here, at this place, but we've had lots of scholarships. That's another way of blessing. Like Marian was like saying, could I come for a day, one or 2 days?
Only money for 1 or 2 days.
Only make money for 1 or 2 days, but yeah. I'd love to come for the whole week, and that'd be fun to have you for the whole week. So we worked out like a partial scholarship, and look at how Marian has blessed all of us so abundantly from that. So we leave it in the Spirit's hands, really. You do.
This morning, I got to donate, and the box was gone.
It's bad. It's bad. It's bad.
So, even the music that we're sharing from the open heart, if you go into our Bandcamp page, there's a system that says, pay it forward. We wanted to call it something, because we didn't know how to explain this, because when you come there, and if you don't have the money to pay, we don't want that to stop anyone, not even online. And so that you can even download all of our music for free if you go online, or you can make a donation. So that's the whole point, like that's what David, he's saying, freely you have been given, now freely give. And so this is so different to learn and see that we're given something to extend it. So it's the gift that we're given, and we just continue giving it. And then we get even more, so to speak, of the giving, because we can't help being ourselves, you know? And, of course, you find teachings, you know, you just go to the Spreaker channel. You'll have thousands, I'm sure, of hours by now of just free teachings of just soaking your mind in all this beauty and going deeper and deeper. So it's all over the place. It's like all YouTube and everything.
Here's a mic, Chris.
Thank you.
Yeah, I just want to react to what you say, because you said there's thousands of hours on speaker, but I mean, people in your community are putting it there, you know, and those people have to live as well, so part of this money will be used for those things, for the website, for the everything.
But they are so beautiful, people, volunteers, actually, over in, mostly in Kaunas, Utah, they have given everything to support this extension, and you don't see them, but they are behind this, and it's really, really, really beautiful, and the ministry has actually grown, and also this, when I started, I felt I want to give everything. I didn't really have much money. I think my first donation was $20.
You had a debt.
I even had a debt to start off.
Right, you came here.
I didn't even have money to get back home to Sweden when I needed to run away, when I got afraid of David after 3 months. Someone gave me $100 for a bus ticket.
What, you were afraid of him and then he gave
I was
you?
Terrified of David.
And he gave you $200?
No, that was David was gone to Australia for a moment, and someone came to the peace house. I can share it more in detail, but he said, "Do you need something?" And he gave me $100 to. Also this support what you value. Like, we are grown up with this getting mentality, you know, getting mechanism, to try to get things as cheap as possible, everywhere, and. I feel the spirit wants to reverse the whole thinking. Like, what is money, and is it really anything? And you know, so it's a lot about undoing this scarcity thinking. It's been for me a lot like that.
And at Vespa too, Kirsten one time, after she'd been working with me for some years, she said, I meet people, most of the people I meet on the planet, they have money, but it's invested in houses, children, education, clothing, cars, and investments, you know, financial. But she said, it's not that they don't have it, it's sunk. Mm. It's sunk into the things of time and space. We watch Time Zen, it's invested, their money is invested in linear time. And they feel now they can't pull it out. Like, they feel guilty if they reinvest it. But the Spirit's like saying, well, reconsider. There's a greater plan going on, and we need some reinvestment. We need to move some of those resources around to support these communications. I mean, how many times do you go to retreat to undo all of time and space? You know, it's not the kind of thing that you usually go to. Oh, I'm doing counseling, or I'm going to this class or that, but undoing time and space. But that's actually a good use, purposeful use of resources. So that's the way it's gone. You want to share some, Francis? Do you have something?
Yeah, I remember Alison and François actually said the decision they made before they got here is either this or a cruise. There was no doubt in their mind, and this is what they want, you know? This is like the best holiday you can
do. Holiday for the mind.
Holiday for the mind. If that is who you are.
It's a holy day.
Holy day.
And I feel, for me, when I started this, I felt to give everything. I gave everything for my awakening, and I gave everything to spirit, and I feel like I received everything when I did that. I actually received everything, and it's been just so amazing. I was in a group like this, or even bigger, first time I met David, And he said, the first day, he said, "Oh, you're welcome. I have a peace house. You're welcome to come to me," he said to the whole group. And I, in my mind, I envisioned this huge place, this, you know, mansion or big retreat center in a beautiful setting. Because if he is out traveling and meeting groups of 70 people every week and gives out this invitation, you know, it must be a huge place because everybody's going to want to come. Because, you know, I want to come. So I did take him up on it. So a few months later, I did come to the peace house.
Tripod was living there.
Tripod and a big fat guy lived there.
A big what?
A big guy, Charles, was
there.
Oh,
big guy.
Yeah. And two cats, Sam and Tripod. David was out traveling, but he had invited me, and Kirsten was out traveling. But they were the only ones. It wasn't even... It wasn't a community at that time, but I arrived there and this old man was there and the two cats.
You should say first, but when she came across the ocean, she saw two giant angels, like huge, that went all the way up into the sky, telling her to go. But when she first came across, she didn't come to my little peace house, which is a cute little house. She went to Maharishi University in Iowa, which is, you know, you've seen like Jim Carrey's given the commencement. It's a massive, massive place with all kinds of people walking around. What were the groups of men that walked around?
The pandits
from India, and it was this massive center that she had envisioned. So I just invited her to the United States, and that's very connected to me, Maharishi University. So we let her have the big experience of this huge place, but they were grading her meditations. You got graded on your meditations. It was like colors, and so she got frustrated with how large it was, grading meditation. She said, "I'm going down to the peace house." Then you came down.
Yeah.
So you did go to the big place first.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I needed to have those angels come in, because I share with some, actually some people have requested I share about how this came in for me, because I had a son, a 10-year-old son, and it was really kind of hard to take this step to go over, even to this Maharishi Center, which was the first call I got from Spirit, was to go there. And so those two angels appeared and just shared God's love with me so deeply and told me to go. I think I need a specific question about this thing with my child, because I have already shared with some of you.
You told yesterday the story of going to David and leaving your son. Mm-hmm. And you said what helped was working on my felt of guilt. And I shared I always have a lot of feelings of guilt for a lot of reasons. But how do you really work get rid of my guilt, but maybe it's to offer my guilt, or how did you do that?
Yeah, I really had to face my guilt, and it came up in so many ways and so many times. And it was projected onto this scenario with my son. That was the big, big thing, because it's not really coming from that. So I learned so much from David and from reading the Course that this guilt is ontological. It's like, it's the guilt of believing that I am separate from God, that I'm not who I really, truly am. So I, just to know that the guilt is not actually because I'm not with my son. Guilt is not because of some circumstance in the world. that helped me to face it and to withdraw it from those events and take it back to the core issue. And it was actually a very shaky time to really face it, and I needed to give myself some space to do that, to not be in all the distractions of the world and in the mother role and all of that. I needed to take myself away from that. And then it was so intense, the fear of God came up, which was like, you know, the core, and I thought I was going to die. I thought I lost my mind. I thought that David ruined my life. I thought I was completely messed up, and that there was no one in this world that would understand me. Mm-hmm. And I shut myself off from David because he was the symbol of love, and I got so afraid. So I had no one, and because he was the only one, the only one that he was given from spirit to trust for me. He was sharing this wisdom. And when I couldn't trust the only one that was given, you know, there was really no one. And I really called, and that was my path of learning to know that I am spirit and that there is nothing to fear, but it was to go through that fear. Yeah, of no one and nothing to trust. So it was a very intense period of 7 months of complete loneliness and trying to join with people, but feeling like there is no joining with people. So it was my mind was confused and lost and fearful, because I also had had a love experience, not of this world, with David when I was together with him first. It was this love and light that was amazing, that took me out of time and space first. So I had had an experience of the personal is not real, and time is not real, it's only now. So then coming back into an experience of time was so strange. It was like every moment was filled with fear, and I had to force myself, or try to walk even, try to take steps, try to interact in the world. And that was my way of learning to trust and rely on spirit only. And it was quite amazing. And I had to give over my son, who is a very beautiful boy, and he was 10 years old at the time. He will be 20 now in a couple of months. And I knew that I needed to do that. I just needed to give over the things in my life completely to because I needed to undo this personal self, like the concepts and the roles. But I also doubted so much. I was thinking that either I'm insane or God is insane. Mm-hmm. You know? Because I thought that if God is calling me away from being a mother and being with my son, then God is not loving, you know, because this little boy, he needs me, you know. I thought he needed me. So, but there was another part of my mind that felt so called, so strongly called to go for this and to heal my mind completely. That I also knew that I needed to undo this concept, the belief of being a mother, and all the beliefs, not just that belief, but all my beliefs. And that was also clear when I met the angels, because they came in the moment when I thought that I can't answer this call. I cannot do this. God is cruel. And in that moment, that's when the light beings appeared, and they just emanated this love. They took me in, and I was one with them. There was no time anymore, and they communicated much faster than a voice, you know, because a voice is speaking, someone else is listening, and it's time involved. But in the communication with them, there was no time. It was immediate. And they answered all my questions immediately. And then they told me... Then they told me that they are grateful that I'm going to go on the journey. But the amazing thing with it, and how I learned that I need to look at all my beliefs, was that these light beings were my parents. They were my mom and my dad in their pure selves. They were my parents. Not the self-concept parents that I knew, but the essence, they were them. There was no doubt. And they were real. And they told me to go. And I don't mean, for me, it looked like going to America, you know. It's not always, it's about a change in the form, although often it is. But what I want to say was that I find it so beautiful that it was my parents, because I realized I don't know my parents. I realized that the ones that I meet, that invite me for dinners and keep being so annoying and hold my attention, that's not who they are. There is something wrong with my perception, because this perception was true. You know, this experience of them, that was pure, that was real, and that was love. So I learned that, oh my God, I have some stuff to look at. I have some work to do, and there is no time to waste. There is no thing to waste. There was no doubt that this is it, and I don't want to waste any more, any other moment. And so that was so helpful, because I knew I needed to work with my mind. There is no other mind to work with. I don't, and my son doesn't even need me in that, when I realize I need to work with my mind. And in form, he was perfectly taken care of, and he healed. Immediately when I left, he healed some deep stuff that he had, you know. So it is true, the lesson, when I'm healed, I'm not healed alone. Mm-hmm. It really worked. And of course, in form, it's still, for years, there were, you know, some weird communication of things going on, because that's the mind. It looks however it looks, you know. And he expressed doubts, and the reflection of my own doubts came up from him saying, "Mom, can you come home? Can you be normal, Mom?" You know, which I tried during that time when I was running away from David. I thought, okay, I'm gonna. That's the only thing I knew. We always go back to what we believe is safe. So I went back to that, and I couldn't do that. I was not a good mother anymore. I had been actually a very good mother for 10 years, because I loved him so much, and I was giving my all to be this good mother, and it was beautiful for my own learning. But then that was maximized completely. I couldn't do that anymore, and I was shown I couldn't do that anymore. I even tried to go with him to soccer matches to see other parents, but I felt like an alien. I felt like, what's going on? I don't know what these characters are up to anymore.
It takes a lot of integration. Like, you here over these 5 days, you might notice you have some major breakthroughs and releases, but then to integrate that, or the Course, Jesus calls it transfer of training in the workbook. if that's what the lesson is to transfer the training to everything and everyone without exception. And it takes willingness, it takes really determination to, it's almost like a lighthouse, you know, at the edge of the sea, where the lighthouse has a bright light that has, it goes around 360 degrees. And imagine in the dark sky, the Holy Spirit's like this beam of light that's saying, I need to do a full sweep. I need to do a full 360 sweep in your mind. This beam of light, like the lighthouse. Let it go all the way around. And there's certain areas where the ego doesn't want to let the light go. It wants to protect those dark spots. I know too, when I work with the Course, if you go into the later parts of the text, you have these self-concept versus self section, where basically you see that the whole Course is about undoing the make-believe self-concept. And that self-concept is more than just the mother concept. It's everything in the world that is believed to be real is part of this cosmic self-concept that was made by the ego to take the place of spirit, the Christ. And so it takes a lot of faith to let your mind fully go from upside down to right side up. And you have to question everything that you believe in. And what's it, lesson 189? It's that beautiful paragraph that begins, simply do this, be still, lay aside all thoughts of what you are, what God is, and goes on to say, hold on to nothing. Do not bring one thought to pass this time with you. Forget this world, forget this Course, and come with holy, empty hands unto your God. I remember I would have the heart chords going whenever I would read that paragraph, because it was very much like the Buddha calling the mind into the emptiness. It's Jesus saying, we need to drop to know all these conceptual knowings. And then Jenny's parable, like a lot of the parables that we could share, could seem rather radical and extreme, and yet when you think back to Jesus 2,000 years ago, he would say things like, I'm calling you out of the world, my kingdom is not of this world, who is my father, mother, sister, brother? He that does the will of our Father in heaven. And basically, the more we know a little bit about the apostles, the Urantia book helps us out, the last section of the Urantia book on the life and teachings of Jesus. But Peter, some people remember the apostle Peter that was with Jesus. He was married with children when he got called by Jesus. He was married, he had children, he had a family, he had his job, his vocation, and then he just looked into Jesus' eyes, and Jesus just said to him, follow me. And so he had to question that. He had to let go, even temporarily, of that self-concept, to hang on to that wild ride of 3 years of public ministry with Jesus. And there were many miracles, and it was a big loosening of the self-concept. But so it's not like there are precedents for these things, even historically, even with Jesus. But again, it comes down to the calling. You're not so much leaving behind anything as you are embracing your calling. That's really what's going on. The ego will emphasize the leaving behind part and say, woe is you, who have to sacrifice all these things. And really the Spirit's like saying, I'm calling you. Will you answer the call? Will you accept the call? That's really what's going on. Yes?
Can you shine that light on relations, intimacy, and sexuality?
Yeah, I think we could say that, as I said the other day, the world and the realm of time and space is the realm of specialness, and so the only one that can undo that specialness for good and completely is the Holy Spirit. So the curriculum is highly individualized in the sense that For some, like I had one singer-songwriter that I traveled with who had been very, very sexually active her whole life, exposed to sexuality at a very young age, and was very, you could even say, promiscuous. She was very sexually active and very promiscuous. And the more we traveled, the more we tuned into Jesus and the Holy Spirit, she started to get the guidance to be celibate. Almost like Jesus said, well, you play that end out. Now, I want you to practice with celibacy. And I want you to watch your thoughts. Another friend of mine who traveled with me, she was very young. She was only 14 years old when she was part of a Catholic family. She went into the convent at 14. And from 14 all the way through to like 22, she was in the convent. And when I traveled with her, she was dealing with all kinds of repression and suppression. Like, where the other one was very promiscuous and was in dealing with indulgence, massive indulgence. This woman was dealing with like 8 years of, during puberty and young adulthood, of complete suppression and repression. So what did Jesus do with her? Well, when we went out, we were down in Florida, and they had a Course in Miracles group at a nudist colony. And so here's Miss Nun, who's really suppressed sexually, and Jesus takes her to a Course in Miracles group at a nudist colony. So I said, okay, that's interesting. I didn't go, but I dropped her off. I dropped her off. He didn't tell me about it. And then when we got out west, how did Jesus deal? We had some friends, the Luckets, who were baptizing people in the creek beds of Sedona. And a group of people said, come on, we're going skin dipping, swimming naked in the creeks. And she was like, okay, Jesus wants me to go skinny dipping. You see, nudist colony, skinny dipping for the one who's repressed sexually. And then for the one who's very promiscuous sexually, let's try celibacy. Because in Buddhism, they call it the middle way. You've heard of Buddhism, you know, if you pull the string too tight, it will snap. And if you let the string be too loose, it will not play. And I think Jesus' version of the middle way is called the miracle. He's going to draw us higher and higher in vibrations, but he's in charge. And he knows what we need based on where we are individually. So there's no kind of set answer for everybody about how it has to go sexually and this and that. And everyone's a little bit different. I mean, I didn't go on my first date till I was 27 years old. So I missed out on dating and relationships and everything until 27. And then still, with relationships, there's a lot of mirroring that goes on. There's a lot of healing. So I think all of us could speak to that, because that's part of the human condition. Diet, sexuality, you know, use of skills. But over time, the shy one ended up being the speaker, the talking mystic. The one who was the quietest was the one who ended up speaking the most words. The one who was afraid of singing ended up doing many music videos and oodles of music and harmonizing and liquid bands springing up here and there. And she was afraid to sing. She had all these fears that she went to school to undo her fears. And Francis was a brilliant student. Francis got scholarship and left China and came to the United States and studied at the University of Chicago. But she was a brilliant student, very competent, ended up forming her own business, and what the world would say, climbing the ladder to success, own business, and married, and properties, and, you know, those kind of things, the world would say, oh, you're secure. You're a very competent, successful woman, which she's thrown all that away. If you listen to her story, you know, it was just used as part of her journey, but she's stepped out of that story completely. And then Jenny's story, too, of being the mother of a 10-year-old and then being so strongly called, that's an unusual story, too. It's not one you hear very often. Maybe if you read the books of the Far East and a lot of mothers who have gone to India and have gone into these deep mystical states and samadhi states, and they'll write about it, how they had to let go of those concepts. But those are pretty rare. You don't hear about those stories very often in society, but they're still there.
Someone asked about the word symbols before.
Symbols.
And we see everything as symbols. Like in the past, we kind of were like identified with if we were in a relationship or I am a wife or I am this or that. But now we call it symbols. And if there's still like a need or like, oh, I want a relationship, right? You know, okay, I give that over to spirit. And if it is most helpful for me, it does come back. So I'm married right now, but it feels like very light. Like, I feel like really I'm married to God, and that is the strongest for me. And it's a bit peripheral, although it's also very honored, I would say, like the relationship or the marriage, and guided. Like we were just recently guided to be apart for almost 6 months, and Greg is coming back today to stay, and I come back tomorrow, so we come together again tomorrow.
But
it's a bit romantic, but it's very, it's so gentle. Like, you know, when we give our lives over, even what we need is actually provided. And yeah, there are no rules. Sexuality comes in or not, you know, whatever is most helpful comes in to our lives. And yeah.
Yeah, it takes a lot to trust, because when you're practicing with no private thoughts and no people-pleasing as your guidelines, instead of taking vows, like there are a lot of traditional Buddhist and Christian communities where they take vows of poverty, chastity, and obedience. And I've given talks about those vows where poverty isn't necessarily talking about take a vow to be poor, although some people do interpret that. They think St. Clair, Francis's person that was part of his community, they're called the Poor Clares now. Basically, that's the name of the order. It's still going, the Poor Clares. But poverty, to me, was non-possession. When we start to possess things, then they possess us. The ego takes over, and then we feel taken away. And chastity, if you look in the dictionary, it means purity of thought with relation to sexual matters. But purity of thought is basically what we're going through with the Course in Miracles as well. And obedience, oftentimes they say obedience to Mother Superior or to the, you know, to a priest or to someone who's heading a monastery or something. Obedience, really, we take that to be obedience to the spirit within, to your intuition. And so not obedient to a person, but obedient to inner guidance and following that guidance.
I have a question about...
Thank you, David. I have a question. Could you please expand on the theme which you all mentioned, the spirit? There is a lot about spirit, spiritualism. There are many kinds of spirits, even in the Christian world, the Holy Spirit and non-Holy Spirit. And could you please put it against soul? Yeah. I mean, the principle of soul, the idea of soul is already defined in the Course. How do you relate soul, spirit, and mind? together, please? Just for clarity.
Yeah, those are words. I mean, obviously, if you look at the Ur text, you'll see the word soul a lot more, and then that was taken out of the what we call our published version. And I would say of the three, soul has a lot of different connotations, because it can be part of reincarnation, and it's almost like soul can be part of like a soul with a capital S, or souls, like that every person has a soul. And then you get into multiplicity of the souls and lessons of the soul and so on and so forth. Whereas spirit, I take that to be perfect, divine order, love, light, abstraction. The Course would say the spirit is abstract. It doesn't have any individual connotations. We could say it's indivisible, but we wouldn't say it's individual. It's indivisible. And mind, again, you could say, the Course talks about the mind of God and does say that the mind is the activating agent of spirit. So basically, Jesus is using that term, a very psychological term, to have a realm that's really tied into consciousness and mind training, and unless it's capitalized. And then when we have the capital mind, like the mind of God or the mind of Christ, that's abstract too. That's very abstract, like spirit. The Course was translated into maybe 23 different languages, and in French, for example, they do not have different words for mind and spirit. L'esprit. One word. You see? And so they imagine how thick the book is. They're trying to convey the meaning of the Course, but there's only one word for spirit and mind. And it might be the same thing like we talk about the snow. If you went to Alaska or Iceland, they probably have different words for snow. It's just not... We have one word for snow. They have many words for snow because there's all these nuances. It's so much a part of their culture.
It's so the same in Dutch. We had to invent a new word to translate mind and have it apart from spirit.
Yeah.
Denkgeest. It's just a new word they invented especially to translate the Course.
It's a sniglet.
What's that?
But sniglet we call when you invent words. Sniglets. Yeah. Okay, we've got a couple. One back there. Yes.
I wonder, in your communities, do you do this no private thoughts all the time, or are there special set times to practice it?
Well, there are expression sessions, oftentimes at lunch, but oftentimes there'll be like a miracle moment or an opportunity in the morning, and then another opportunity around lunchtime. It's more of a general practice too, and I would say like as the deeper you go with the practice, you start to go into this deep mystical telepathic experience, and so you know, it's not something that has to say. I know Helena's community, there's a lot of times with your Ruba gatherings and daily practice, it goes into silence. It really depends on where the mind is. If the mind's ready to go into that, it becomes less of a practice that has like a start time, or it becomes less of an activity to a living experience. And I think it's the same with meditation. At the beginning, is people like to have a start time and a stop time for their meditations, or various breathing techniques, various postures. But the more you go into the depth of what that stillness is, it becomes a presence, it becomes a state of mind. You, like the Buddhists call it mindfulness, you can do open-eyed meditations, your whole day can become a meditation as you go more in a devoted way with it. So it depends on the center, and it also depends on the group of people that are there.
But it is possible to do it all the time?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And I was also wondering, is that when you facilitate a group, how you facilitate a group, sticking with this one?
We have a facilitator,
Yeah. So when we do this group expression sessions, that's what you do. You stay in truth and you don't follow or you don't try to understand what somebody is saying.
Yeah.
You stay with
yourself. You stay with yourself, yeah.
Thank you.
Yes,
I saw. I really love like Tony Parsons and Lisa Cairns. I met them a couple of times, and I saw you yesterday. Yesterday, I spoke about you that Lisa is pointing to, like the cause is like, maybe where the cause is pointing to is the same. You know, Lisa.
Yes.
But she takes all away all the words. There is nothing. And sometimes I think it's helpful maybe to get to, but sometimes it's confused. Do you know if the cause is then maybe, I don't want to say that. Kindergarten? No, I remember old trap.
Kindergarten?
Yeah, I see that I remember old trap. I want to be clever.
She had a question too.
But sometimes the words because Lisa Cairns, I saw in this interview you and yesterday with Lisa Cairns, like the words is she, I love that about her, like she, the other words like Holy Spirit, nothing. Do you know what I mean? How is the course? No, what? If this is helpful. Sometimes I think we. It's also a distraction to have all these words. Yeah, all these words.
Yeah,
like Holy Spirit, the mind, soul, the fucker. That is.
The Course just says that it's one path among many forms of the universal curriculum. And there will be many teachers of the universal curriculum, and there have been over the ages. And some are pathways that are more introspective and meditative. And if you look at like Advaita Vedanta or Ramana Maharshi, it's self-inquiry. It's basically, who am I? It's the central tool. That's almost like if you were going to peel the onion of consciousness, Ramana just gives you a sharp knife called, who am I?
And Lisa
don't
even give you the knife.
And maybe even that. But what you'll find, again, is you shall know them by their fruits. So people, for example, one time somebody went all the way to India to talk to Gandhi, Mahatma Gandhi, and they said to Gandhi, just what do you believe? Are you a Hindu, or are you kind of a composite? You have like a composite religion that kind of pulls from a lot of religions, or this and this, and he just said, why don't you follow me around and live with me for a while? Then you'll find out. If there's anybody where you have a strong draw to them and a resonance, then that's why. There was a woman recently, a friend of ours, Sandy from Hungary, and she saw Helena in a dream. She's also worked with me, with us, Lisa Cairns, she's very drawn to, and so she was trying to dress Helena like Lisa. She got there at rural Sweden. She's saying, now Lisa wears this, and we can get these secondhand, and I can make you look like Lisa. But the thing about it is, you shall know them by their fruits. In other words, words, it's more what presence is using the words. What's the purpose behind the words? There could be a lot of words used in different ways to point to the same thing. And if they're used with integrity, and they're coming from a place of joy and happiness and love and laughter, whether there's a lot of words or not, you're going to feel that.
Yes, thank you, Madam.
So it takes it beyond the whole question of words. And the Course does have a lot of words. But again, you know, Helen Schuckman said, you know, at last a pathway for intellectuals. So, you know, it's meant to help you undo the intellectual mind. And that's important too.
Yes.
And they deserve a pathway too, intellectually. Doesn't everyone? Even the butterflies and snails, you know, they need a pathway back to oneness. So, you know, so you learn, we're not going to be critical. sometimes people talk about the course and they'll say it's this, it's this, and this, and this, and then I look, they've never read the course. They're making commentary on a book that they've never even read. It would be like me talking about horticulture or something. I don't know anything about horticulture. I was in China one time and I did a gathering in Shanghai, and then I went down to Hainan. It's like an island in southern China. And I said hi everybody and talked and had a fun time, and then I said, okay, are there any questions? And the first question, the guy goes, yeah, yeah. He said, I was just with you in Shanghai, and I was with you for some days down there, and I didn't learn anything at all from you. Nothing. I didn't get a thing out of the talks. So now I've traveled all the way down to Hainan, and he's the first one. So can you tell me, am I going to get something from you? And I said, no. If you hang around me, you not only won't get something, you'll lose everything that you think you've got. And the place just, all these Chinese people roared laughing, and off we went, you know, and he left, too. Because I'm not into getting. I don't think we should be consumers, spiritual human being consumers trying to get metaphysical knowledge. We want an experience that comes from releasing our concepts, not from getting more concepts. So, you know, it's you just have to really go close to it. Did you have your hand up?
Yes, we have been practicing every day these expression sessions. The first day was explained to us that we express a very deep, strong feeling that even gets up to here. And then we don't comment anything on it. No reaction, no answer, or no solution, or nothing. That's it. Just let it come out, and that's it. Then in the following days, somehow the practice changed in the group I was in, and I really want to understand this tool, since you do it every day, it must mean something, so I want to understand. Can you again explain it to me in very simple way? Is this the meaning, to get out the feelings that get in the way, that, you know, are not peace, not oneness, to come to the underlying beliefs, thought system, so that it can become clear to you, that you get free? Or is it just expressing anything? And then, I just wanted to ask, is the facilitator just being present, like we practicing the one and two thing, or command and guiding and...
Yeah, I think it's good. This will be our last question because we're right almost at our lunchtime. But the first premise was to allow those emotions up into awareness, and if it feels helpful to even speak the emotions without crosstalk, without corrections, without advice giving, without somebody rushing in to, in mid-sentence, to say, stop, I can help you fix that, without trying to fix it, because they're so repressed and denied from awareness that they have to be allowed up. It would be like if you planted a garden and you till the soil and you put some seeds down in it, and then you water the soil, and then you put some plastic over the top so no sunlight can get into those seeds, and then you put bricks and rocks on top of your garden, not really giving those seeds very much of a chance to germinate because of the blocks, because of the pushing down that would go from plastic and bricks and rocks. And the same, we have to break that habit of stuffing So we want to encourage the feelings up. But ultimately, it's a practice in non-judgment. Because that's really what we need to practice. We need to be able to be present. We need to be the presence of love there and let those emotions and thoughts come up without criticizing them, without judging, because that's the practice that's going to heal our mind. We have to invite the Holy Spirit to be with us to let those thoughts move through. So that's the simple explanation, and the ego can come back almost like even when you start off in a new group, the next day the ego might be all stirred up and still want to do a little talking and fixing and a little psychotherapy on those expressions. But, you know, that's not really the intention. Okay, we're winding.
So actually, we are practicing in this, when we listen to our brothers in this session, we are practicing non-judgment and he passes by.
Yeah, yes, very much. And that's very supportive. It's very helpful. Okay, so we will take a break for lunch.